Certainly a joyous week for me as I've been at the Hampton Ministers Conference all week long, and God sure finds a way to pour into your soul and speak to you in just the way you need.
Amen.
And so I thank God to add to the list of things that He encouraged that you all have allowed us to do this week. You allowed me to be able to go to the Hampton University Ministers Conference.
Yes.
And receive some world-class training. And so we thank God for that. As we come now to this time of speaking and teaching from God's holy word, I would ask those of you that have your Bibles to return with me to the book of John, the 15th chapter. The book of John, the 15th chapter. And our reading today will commence at verse number 1. Starting at verse number 1, those of you that are able, if you won't mind, please stand for the reading of God's holy word. Today I'll be reading from the NIV version of that holy text. John 15, starting at verse number 1. With your indulgence of time, I ask that you allow me to read down to verse 13. There you will find these words written. It says, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, so that it will be even more fruitful.
Yes.
You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself.
Yes.
It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing.
Yes.
If you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown in the fire, and burned. If you remain in me, my word remains in you. Ask whatever you wish, and I will, and it will be done for you.
Yes.
This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no man than this, to lay down one's life for one's friend." God's word for God's people.
Yes.
And may that a blessing to us all. Eternal God, Father, again, Lord, we just thank you. Thank you, Father God. We thank you for sharing this divine word with us here today, Father God. And we pray, Father God, that your word, that it already fell on fresh and fertile soil in the hearts and minds of these, your precious people.
Yes.
And then, Father God, your man servant, as always, I pray that you would hide me behind the cross, that only you might be seen. Pray, Lord, that you would speak to my mind and speak through these lips of clay, that I might give your word as you have given it unto me.
Yes.
Then, as always, Father God, I ask for preaching power, the kind of power that makes preaching easy. And, Lord, I ask all these things in your Son, Jesus Christ, and our Lord and Savior, in his holy and his precious name. And let the church say, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Be seated in the presence of our Lord. For the moments that we have to share this morning, church, I want to talk about staying connected to Jesus Christ. Staying connected to Jesus Christ. Many of us in here are old enough to remember a time when the only way that you could stay connected with someone was to write them a letter or call them on the phone. And if you're old enough in here to remember what some of us call the good old days, then you remember that connecting with people then was not like connecting with people now. Because now if you want to connect with somebody, you can email them, text them, or you can call them. And you can almost be assured that whichever way you decide to connect, you're probably going to get there. Some of you know that it hasn't always been that way.
Yeah.
But there was a time, young people, when we didn't have cell phones.
Amen.
There wasn't no such thing as the World Wide Web. We didn't email. We didn't text. Because all we could do was call somebody.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. They didn't answer. Your best option was to either call them later or call them tomorrow.
Yeah, that's right.
Some of us can even remember a time when we didn't have no answering machine.
Yes.
There was no such thing as call waiting.
Yes.
When I was growing up, the only call waiting we had was when my grandmama was waiting on the call.
Amen.
She would tell you, don't get on the phone inside that line. I'm waiting on a call. When she wanted to interrupt the call and somebody was on the phone too long, she would tell you, boy, run down there and tell her to get off that phone. Because I'm trying to give her a call. But again, that's how it was back in the day. You couldn't leave somebody a message. You could not text them. You couldn't email them right away. But in the world we live in today, people don't want to wait. People don't want to call you back later. Because the world we live in today, people want to be connected all day, every day. Come on now, there's some of us in here that if we found out right now that we left our phone home, we'd get up and leave. Because we don't feel connected without that phone. Uh-huh. And I'll be honest with you, I tell people all the time, I will turn my phone off. I might turn it down, but I don't turn it off. Because in this quest for people to stay connected, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Snapchat, they have become the popular things for people to do.
Yeah.
You see, because with these applications, people can now never feel disconnected.
That's right.
Again, what people want today is they want to always feel connected to their family, their friends, and their foes. People want to go out there in the world and connect with people that they don't even know.
Uh-huh.
There's a caution in being connected all the time. You better be careful, church, of who it is and what it is you get connected to out in this world. You see, because one of the things my grandmama used to tell me is, you are known by the company that you keep. She would say, show me who your friends are, and I'll tell you who you are. Because the old saying is, the birds of a feather, they do flock together.
Yes, yes.
That's why you got to be careful of everybody being your friend. There's some people that you can't connect with, some people that you can't get close to, some people you can't even associate with because some of the stuff on them will rub off on you.
All right.
Amen.
You see, everybody knows that everything that looks good and sounds good ain't always good. That's why in our quest to be connected and stay connected, sometimes we only see what we want to see. Sometimes we're so eager to get connected and get hooked up with people that we miss all the warning signs. And again, I'm sure that there's somebody in here can testify that there's been a time in their life when they were connected to the wrong person.
Uh-huh.
And the reason they got connected was because they missed all the signs, and they were only looking at what they could see with their natural eyes. Mm-hmm. But again, sometimes what you find out is things don't always appear the way they really are.
That's right.
And sometimes what you miss trying to be connected is you miss the fine print. Mm-hmm. See, I tell people all the time, especially young people, what you see out there on the internet and on social media, that ain't who people are. That's just what they want you to know.
All right.
That's right.
And if that's all you get, that's all you pay attention to, you'll miss all the warning signs. I remember talking to this young lady, and she was telling me about she was about to fly to San Diego to go spend the weekend with a man she met on the internet. I asked her what she knew about this fellow, and And she showed me all these pictures of him in his car, him in his job, him, and all this other stuff. And I asked him, has he ever sent you a picture from his house? No, no. Hey, have you ever talked to him until you fell asleep at night?
Uh-huh.
No, no, no. He said he'd go to bed early because he'd wake up and go to the gym. I said, bless her heart. She was just shooting me. She don't realize he had her. She ain't going to spend a weekend with him. He's going away to a conference and he's invited her to be his guest.
Wow.
Why? Because she missed reading the fine print. If she had read the fine print, she would have found out that he was married with children. If she had read the fine print, she would have found out that this ain't the first time he stepped out on his wife. And she would have realized that he was not the knightly shining armor, but he was the worst thing that could have ever happened. Somebody knows what I'm talking about. But that shit don't happen to men, that happened to women too. Come on, ladies. There's some brothers in here that they can testify to that I missed the fine print.
All
right. If I read the fine print, I would have found out that she can't cook and she won't clean. I would have found out that she had some issues in her life and she was going to take it out on me. Every bad thing that had ever happened to her. But I missed the fine print. Because if you read the fine print sometimes, instead of trying to get connected, you'll run in the other direction. That's why we gotta be connected. We gotta be careful of who we connect with in this world. If you want to connect with somebody, the person you need to connect with is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You're gonna get connected with somebody else. One of the first things you wanna find out is, are they connected to?
All right.
Because the truth of the matter is, if they're connected to Jesus, you ought not have to read about it in the fine print. You see, because when they're connected to Jesus Christ, they ought to have a little light.
Yeah.
That little light ought to be shining, and it ought to be shining other than on Sunday morning. And it ought to be shining in such a way that you know that there's something different about them.
Yeah.
So, again, as we're talking about being connected, this ain't nothing new. Because here Jesus is talking more than 2,000 years ago to his ancient disciples about how to be connected. He was not talking about the Jerusalem wireless internet. He was talking about being connected to him. So Jesus wanted his disciples to know that there are some benefits in life to being connected to Jesus Christ.
Yes, yes.
And I believe that that's what Jesus teaches us today, that what the benefits are of being connected to Jesus Christ. The first reason that Jesus said that we need to stay connected to him, church, is to draw from his strength.
Yeah.
Some of us in here can admit that we get weak sometimes.
That's right.
But God said, thanks be to God, when you are weak, he said, I'll be strong.
Amen.
And the reason we got to connect with Jesus is so that we can draw from his strength.
Yeah.
You see, because Jesus starts this text by telling his disciples, this is God, I am the true vine. He does this in a way of letting them know that, listen, regardless of who came before me and regardless who's going to come after me, you need to know that I am the one and only true and living God.
Yes, yes.
The church, what Jesus does is not only does he let them know who he is, but Jesus makes it very clear who they are.
That's right.
Yeah, yeah, they've been walking with him and they've seen him do a lot of things, but Jesus wanted them to know, listen, I am the vine and you are the branch. In other words, Jesus is saying, listen, if you remain in me and I remain in you, then you can bear much fruit.
Uh-huh.
Jesus also said, apart from me, he wanted them to know, you can't do nothing. He said, you ain't nothing more without me than a branch that's been thrown in the fire. Mm-hmm. He said, in other words, without me, you ain't good for nothing.
That's right.
Again, somebody needs to hear me right now, because some of us listen to church, we want to stay connected to the church, yet be disconnected from Jesus Christ.
Okay.
You see, we want to keep our names on the roll. We want to still be considered an active member, but Jesus did not say, if you just stay in the church, if you just keep your membership active, or you just show up every now and then you will bear much fruit. He said, you got to do more than just come to church, but you got to stay connected to me. You see, because Jesus said, as long as you stay connected to me, you'll always bear much fruit. You see, because as long as you stay connected to him, you'll always have life. Because he did say that he came to give us life and to give it to us more abundantly.
Yes.
Again, all I'm trying to tell somebody is, no matter how good you think life is, no matter what you got going on, if you don't do anything else in life, you got to stay connected to Jesus Christ. You see, because when you're connected to him, you can draw strength from his pool of resources. You see, try to make this thing clean. How many of y'all in here ever been sick before? Now, you know, I say sick, I ain't talking about I got a headache or a stomach ache sick. But I'm talking about emergency room sick. I'm talking about spending a week or two in the hospital kind of sick. I'm talking about they got to cut you kind of sick. And see, some of y'all can't testify to that because all you've been healthy all your life. But there's some people in here that can say, Pastor, I've been sick before. You ever been sick when you had to stay in the hospital a day or two? One of the things that you can testify is when you got there, they hooked you up to what they call an IV. And the reason they hooked you up to an IV is so that you can have the strength that you need. Let me tell you something. I ain't no nurse, but one thing I ain't never seen is I ain't never seen an IV connected to somebody in the IV down here. But they always connected to an IV that's somewhere up there. What Jesus is trying to tell somebody is when you're connected to him, you're connected to your spiritual IV. And Jesus will make sure that you have everything that you need. Somebody here can testify that being connected to Jesus, that when you're sad, he lifts you. When you're wrong, he corrects you. When you're hungry, he feeds you. When you're sick, he heals you. And when you're weak, he strengthens you. That's why when you're connected to Jesus, you can truly say, I can do all things through Christ that strengthens you.
Yes, yes.
Why? Because you draw strength from him. But the second thing that he tells us about why we need to stay connected to him first, so that we might draw from his strength, but secondly, so that we might delight in his word. You got to find joy in just reading God's word. Something inside of you ought to be satisfied with just sitting down open the Bible and read. You see, because in verse 7, Jesus throws a curveball on his disciples. Because in verse 7, not only does it say that the branches needed to stay connected to him, but he also said that his branches needed to stay connected to his word. See, again, I don't want you to rush past what Jesus is saying here, church. Because you see, all through the New Testament, Paul teaches us this concept of being in Christ. But the question that Jesus is asking today is not, are you in Christ? But the question he really wants to know is my word inside of you? And the reason this is important is because Jesus knows that right inside of your mouth, you have the power of life and the power of death. You see, because the Bible said that a man is not destroyed by what he puts in his mouth, but a man is destroyed by what comes out of his mouth. Because the Bible says, out of the mouth does the heart speak. See, there's some things that will never come out your mouth if it ain't in your heart. We're trying to help somebody. And you say, no. See, cussing don't come out you. Cussing ain't in
you. All
right. There's something that you ain't going to say if it ain't already in your heart. And that's why when we wake up, we got to ask Jesus to create in us a right spirit and give us a clean heart. See, because somebody here can testify that if you got the wrong thing in your heart, the devil will make it come out. He has a way of making it come out at the wrong time and in front of the wrong people.
All right.
And all the good that you've done, they ain't going to remember none of that. All the sermons you preach, they ain't going to remember none of that.
All right.
All the money you gave, they ain't going to remember that. What they going to remember is, oh, she cussed. Oh, she cussed. Boy, you should have been there. Man, That's all they're going to remember.
That's true.
All your good will be gone away by one moment of something coming out of your mouth. And that's why church Paul said, when I was a child, I spoke like a child.
Yeah.
I acted like a child.
Uh-huh.
But he said,
when I grew up,
I put away Charles' name. Mm-hmm. You see, but many of us miss what Paul is saying because we try to relate what Paul is saying to age.
Yeah, yeah.
Paul is not talking about age, church. Instead, Paul is talking about spiritual maturity. You understand what Paul is saying in this way. You understand that what Paul is really saying is, when I was spiritually immature,
yeah.
and when I didn't have the word inside of me, he said, I spoke like a child, and I act like a child, but the more of his word I got inside of me, I began to grow up, and I began to mature. Spiritually mature, I stopped talking like I used to talk, and I stopped acting like I used to act. Wasn't because of me, and because I got older, he said, no, I just got spiritually mature. Again, part of growing in Christ is looking at yourself and saying, you know what? There was a time when I would have given you a piece of my mind. There was a time when, you know what, I wouldn't let you say that to me and I just walked away. I would have went toe to toe with you.
Yeah.
But now that I got God in my heart, now that I got Jesus in my heart, you know what? I'm going to say, bless the Lord, my soul. I'm going to give you a hug and tell you I love you. And I'm going to sit here and argue with you. Because you know what those folks used to say, don't argue with no fool.
That's right.
Because people who don't know will be confused about who the fool is.
All right. All right.
But you don't know that when you're young. You don't know who you're born. Again, what I'm trying to tell somebody is, what Jesus is saying is, when you leave here today, if you don't leave here with anything else, you ought to leave here with God's word inside of you.
Yeah.
Because when you learn to delight in God's word, and when you learn to live by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God, God's word will start doing something for you.
Yes, yes.
Again, when you start... You start hiding the word of God in your heart that you might not sin against God. That's when his word will be a lamp unto your feet and a light unto your path. That's when you're sick that his word will be medicine in your body. When you're lonely, his word will be a constant companion. And when you're worried, his word will give you peace. That's what passes all your understanding.
Yes.
You see, because Jesus said to his disciple, listen, when you learn to delight in my word, you can ask me for anything. He said, no matter what you ask, he said, I'll give it to you. See, that's enough for me right there to want to open my Bible. When Jesus, just to read that scripture right there, when he said, Shawn, ask me for whatever you want,
Jesus.
And I'll give it to
you.
But lastly, Jesus teaches us about staying connected to him. He says, so that we might depend on his love.
Yes.
It's one thing to draw from his strength. That's really nice. This is one thing to delight in his word. But Jesus says you also got to depend on his love.
Mm-hmm.
You said that Jesus makes the final move in this text, church, by telling his disciples, as the Father has loved me,
yes,
so I have loved you. Now remain in my love.
Yeah.
This word we use, remain, in the Greek, this is the same word for stay connected.
Uh-huh.
And Jesus is telling his disciples here, listen, you got to do more than just stay connected to family and friends. You got to do more than just stay connected to the church. You see, because Jesus understood that the enemy is not just in the world, but the enemy operates even in the church.
All right.
Yes.
That's why Jesus said, listen, even in the church, you got to stay connected to me and my love.
Yes.
Jesus understood that some of the hardest people to love is church folks.
Mm-hmm.
That's why Jesus said, you got to love folks like I loved you.
All right.
And we do know that Jesus was always about his Father's business because he made that declaration at a young age. Because see, why Jesus wants us to stay connected to his love is because, listen, when you're connected to him, you have access to his love.
Yes.
You know, it's like when you got children. You know, your children ought not have to beg you to take care of them.
That's right.
It's a very got a baby to feed them.
That's right.
Now, you do that because they connected to you.
Yeah.
That's right.
This is a very poor parent. Your children got a baby to provide for all their needs. Mm. No, you do that because they're your children.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What Jesus is telling you and I is that when you're connected to me, you have access to some stuff that I have.
All right.
And one of the things that we have access to is his love. And as long as you got the love of Jesus in your heart, then you got access to his joy.
Mm-hmm.
That's what he was telling his disciples. He was telling his disciples, if you want joy, unspeakable joy, then all you got to do is stay connected to me.
Uh-huh.
You see, church, because that's what Jesus wants for everybody in here right now. He wants you to leave here today with joy. Not joy from the world or from money, drugs, or anything else. No, Jesus wants you to have joy, unspeakable joy. The kind of joy that the world can't give you, and the kind of joy that the world can't take away.
Yes.
He wants you to have the kind of joy that I have you waking up early in the morning. The kind of joy that I have you dancing late into the night.
Yeah.
Because here's what Jesus says. Jesus wants everybody in here to know that, listen, if you don't have my joy, whatever kind of joy you got is temporary and it's incomplete.
Uh-huh.
He said, let me tell you that it's going to run out. It ain't going to last always. But he said, if you can never get connected to me, and if you can find joy in Jesus Christ,
yes.
He said, no matter what comes your way, you're going to be all right. But as again, as I get ready to bring this to a close, there's one more thing I want to remind somebody of what Jesus says here in this text. Jesus said, here is my command is this. This is his command. We know the command that Moses gave us, but Jesus said, here's my command. That you love each other.
Yes.
As I have loved you.
Yes.
And that's in my full church. You see, because one of the things that we know about Jesus is he just didn't love those that loved him.
That's right.
He just didn't love those that agreed with what he was saying and what he was doing. But my Bible teaches me that Jesus even loved his enemies.
Yeah.
What Jesus is trying to tell us is if you stay connected to him, mm-hmm. if you stay connected to his love, then you ought to be able to love everybody. I need everybody.
Uh-huh.
And if there's somebody that you cannot love, you just can't bring yourself to love them, you got to ask yourself, where's the God in that?
All right.
And even the people that was hanging him on the cross, my Bible said that Jesus said, Father, forgive them. Because they know not what they do. Again, all of us need to leave here today with that in our hearts. Because again, some of us only want to love those that love us back.
Uh-huh.
Some of us only want to love those that agree with us or make us feel good. Some of us only want to love those that we can get along with. But as you mature in the faith and you get more of God's word in you, you understand that you even got to love folks that you know hate you.
Yeah.
Because you don't have to answer for other folks.
That's right.
All you got to do is answer for yourself. Jesus said, love other people the way that I have loved you. Here's a reminder of how Jesus loved us. He didn't start loving us when we got ourselves together.
All right.
Jesus didn't start loving us when we walked down and joined the church. He didn't start loving us after he had picked us up and turned us around and placed our feet on solid ground. No, my Bible said that he loved us while we were still his sons.
Amen.
In other words, Jesus loved you while you were still out in the streets. He loved you while you were still doing your stuff. Jesus looked beyond all of your faults. And he simply saw your need. Here because Jesus, God is the one that created us. And God knows that inside of every one of us, we have a basic need to be loved.
Yes.
Okay, who you are? Care what money you got. All of us need to be loved.
Yes.
Jesus said, you got to love people the way that I loved you. In other words, Jesus said, think about how many times you messed up.
Yeah.
He said in his word that the wages of sin is death, but you still live it.
Yeah.
get what you should have got when you messed up. In other words, instead of getting what you should have got, you got mercy.
Yeah.
That's how Jesus loves us. He loves us with grace and mercy.
Yes.
Made us a promise that grace and mercy would follow you all the
days. Yes. All right.
The things that are happening to you that you didn't earn, you don't deserve. He said, you call that grace.
Yes, Lord. Thank you.
There's some stuff that ought to happen to you, but I'm not going to allow it to happen to you. Why? Because of my mercy.
Yes, Jesus. Yes, Lord.
And he said, now that's what you ought to have for other people.
Because
Jesus loved everybody, church. My Bible does not say that Jesus went to the cross for the educated or the rich.
Yes, yes.
He just didn't go for white people or black people.
Yes.
He didn't go for just for the Baptist or the Methodist or the Catholic or the Lutheran. No, my Bible said that he went for everybody. Mm-hmm. He just didn't go to the cross for it. While he was there, he humbled and died.
Yes, yes.
While he was there, he went down into a borrowed tomb and he stayed there Friday and all day Saturday, but thanks be to God. He got a word on Sunday morning. And all power in his hand. What God is trying to say to every person in here, that we all need to stay connected to him.
Yes.
And now more than ever. And I'm doing it. I was listening. I normally wake up on Sundays and listen to some preaching so I can get preaching in my spirit. I was listening to Edwin Smith this morning. He was preaching about chaos, storms of life. And you know, many of you have seen the news this week where Kate Spade took her own life.
Yeah.
Anthony Bourdain took his life.
Yeah.
I'm so sorry for that. But you know, that dark night of the soul. Mm. There are many people, there are probably some people sitting in here right now wrestling with the dark night of the soul. Because they tell us now that 30% of the people who commit suicide, they've shown no signs.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You think everything's all right. And if you want to just put it in perspective, the danger that suicide is becoming in America, just put this in the context. Put this in the context. There's been about 2,000 soldiers killed since 2000. From 2000 to 2018, there's been about 2,000 soldiers killed. Yet, 22 soldiers a day take their own lives from suicide. That means this year, about 6,600 soldiers are going to commit suicide. Only 2,000 died in combat in 18 years. 6,600 will take their lives this year. You don't know what people are going through.
That's right.
You don't know the struggles that people have in their mind.
Yes.
The black night of the soul can attack any of us at any time.
That's right.
And that's why when people come to church, the best thing that we can do is just love them.
Yes.
That's the best thing that we can do when people come to church is wrap our arms around them and tell them I love you. No matter what. Because you don't know what people are struggling with.
Yes.
You don't know how close they are to the edge. And that one bad look, that one bad comment, whatever, could be the thing
that
pushed them over.
Jesus, yes.
Instead of you being the thing that held on to me, you pulled them away from me. Mm-hmm. So we got to be careful and stay connected to Jesus.
Yes.
Love one another. Because you just never know what people are going through.
Mm-hmm.
Don't assume that they got money, because Kate Spade had plenty of money.
Yep.
Anthony Bourdain had plenty of money.
Yes.
Money couldn't save them. That's a battle that money can't win. Father, in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
Lord, we do thank you for allowing fragile, broken branches like us to be connected to you, the true vine. We thank you, Father God, for allowing us to draw strength from you. We thank you, Father God, for allowing us to delight in your word. But we also thank you, Father God, for allowing us to depend on your love.
Yes,
we know, Father God, that love should be all around us, but it's not always there. But we thank you, Father God, that you made us a promise that you would always love us, even to the ends of the earth. And so, Father God, again, we do thank you for allowing your word to come down and commune with us for just a little while. We thank you, Father God, for all your precious people that are here under the sound of my voice. And we just pray, Father God, that all of those that had an ear could hear what thus saith the Lord. And we pray, Father God, that you would use this word today to till up the soils of our hearts, Father God, so that your word might not fall on hard ground, but your word might fall in the places where you would have it to fall, so that, Father God, we might be transformed from the inside to the outside. And so, God, we do thank you and we do praise you. Father God, we pray that your heavenly angels will take this word today, Father God, to not only those that are here, but those that could not be here.
Yes.
Father God, even let your word go to the sick and the shut-in today. Wherever they might be, Father God, use this word too to minister to their hearts and to their minds.
Yes.
Speak to them in such a way, Father God, that they know that they too have heard from you. And so, Father God, in the name of Jesus, we do thank you. We pray your continued blessings upon this branch of Zion, Father God. You've been walking with this branch now for almost 149 years, Father God. Father God, the wonders and amazements that you have done, eyes, Father God, still have not seen and ears have not heard what you still have in store for us.
Yes.
So, Father God, we're going to stay connected to you no matter what comes our way. No matter how difficult it may seem, we're going to stay connected to you.
Yes.
And so, God, we do thank you and we do praise you. And so now, Father God, we ask a special prayer for your children, Father God, that are here today that need to be saved.
Yes.
We open up the doors of your church by extending the invitation. If there may be one person in here today, Father God, that needs to be saved. One person, Father God, that needs to accept your invitation of whosoever will, just let them come. We just pray right now in the name of Jesus that you would give them the strength that they need to come forth and say yes, Lord. The second invitation for anybody in here, Father God, that they've been saved, but they haven't been living a saved kind of life. They haven't been living the kind of life that is pleasing and acceptable in your sight. And your word today for them is, you can always come back home.
Yes.
Father God, we pray that if any of your children have become disconnected from you, then in the name of Jesus, Father God, you would allow them right now to reconnect with you. And then lastly, Father God, the last invitation for anybody in here that needs a church home. Father God, you know who your children are. You know what they stand in need of. And if it's your plan, your will for them to be a member of Martin Street Baptist Church, 1001 East Martin Street, Raleigh, North Carolina. And Father God, in the name of Jesus, we pray that you would connect with them right now so that they might connect with us. And they might come and be a part of this great church and be a part of what it is that you're doing for us right now. In the name of Jesus, Father God, we have prayed your prayer. We have sent your word forth. You declare that your word will never come back to you, boy. So, Father God, we pray that you will now allow your word to accomplish your will.
Yes.
We ask all these things in the darkness of Son of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, in his holy and his precious name. Let the church say, amen.
Amen.
If there one.